In this series of video lectures, we're going to talk about what we call economic fluctuations. And economic fluctuations is the new term that economists use to talk about what they used to call business cycles, which is to say recessions and booms. And before we go sort of deep into any models of recessions and booms, we want to go ahead and talk about what economists sometimes call stylized facts. So stylized facts are things which are a little bit simpler than the actual reality, but are a good way to organize your thoughts about something. So the first one to talk about here is, well, we used to call them business cycles, but the word cycle probably implies a higher level of predictability and regularity than we probably think is appropriate. So, you know, you think about the cycle of the seasons, then they come on a very regular basis and that kind of stuff, or election cycles might come on a very regular basis. But economic fluctuations are irregular and unpredictable. So one way of thinking about this is, how long is it typically between recessions? And sometimes recessions come very long apart, sometimes as long as 8 or 9 years apart, sometimes maybe 4 or 5, and sometimes they can quickly follow one another so that we have what's called a double dip recession. So that's the first one. And that's why we want to call it, again, an economic fluctuation rather than a business cycle. Second one out there is, GDP can help us predict lots of other variables. So when we talk about a recession, a common definition is that a recession is 2 consecutive quarters, 2 consecutive 3-month periods of negative GDP growth. And for a long time, that's what our economic textbooks said a recession was. But actually, this is kind of an interesting to economists at least, historical anecdote is that the real estate bubble and real estate boom started to sort of taper off in the very beginning of 2008. But we had not yet seen that negative GDP growth. Many other indicators in the economy were starting to look like a recession. Unemployment was starting to go up, factory production was starting to go down, but GDP growth had not yet turned negative. And sort of there was a big debate among economists, was the economy in a recession or not? And we looked back into it and we said, oh, this right here, this sort of two-quarter rule, this is not anything official. In fact, there's a group at the National Bureau of Economic Research, NBER, which is a sort of nonpartisan think tank that spans lots of major research universities. And they have what's called their Business Cycle Dating Committee. And essentially, a recession is whatever they say it is. So it's a group of economists sit around and decide when a recession begins or ends. And so more generally, I think, though, what do we mean by a recession? We mean, in some sense, the economy's slowing down and things are getting worse. And what we're going to see here is different parts of GDP behave differently. So say, for instance, investment spending, big I, is very volatile. when GDP is rising, investment spending rises by a lot. And when GDP is going down, investment spending declines by a lot. So businesses and household purchases of houses are very sensitive to the state of the economy. Some portions of consumption spending are also very sensitive. In particular, consumer spending on what we call durable goods, things like cars or furniture or refrigerator. Sort of a durable good is a big ticket item that is expected to last 3 or more years. The exact definition's a little bit loose. On the other hand, non-durable goods and services fluctuate much less. So different parts of GDP behave very differently. The next sort of stylized fact out there is that movements in GDP can help us predict movements in the unemployment rate. And roughly, this is what we're talking about here is what's called Oakens Law. And Oakens Law, basically, we draw a graph that looks something like this. And on this axis, we have GDP growth in a quarter, in a 3-month period. And on this axis, we have the change in the unemployment rate. And what we see here is that, of course, a positive here is bad, a negative would be good. So what we see here is typically that if GDP grows by, say, about 2.5%, then unemployment doesn't change. If GDP growth comes in at zero here, unemployment goes up. And if GDP grows faster than 2.5%, then unemployment goes down. And the reason for this is that most years, the labor force grows about 1% per year, and labor productivity grows by about 1.5% per year. So, if GDP growth catches up with 1 plus 1.5%, or if it matches, 1 plus 1.5%, then we're just creating enough jobs to compensate for the growth in the labor force and sort of the increase in the level of production. If GDP growth is positive but below this, then we're going to go ahead and see that the unemployment rate is going to tend to go up. Because yes, we're producing more stuff, but with higher technology, we don't need as many workers to produce more stuff, and we have more workers coming into the system. So this is essentially the idea here. So faster GDP growth, just to put it in the simplest terms here, faster GDP growth equals faster declines in the unemployment rate. And slow GDP growth, slow is less than 2.5, means a slow rise in GDP growth, a slow rise in unemployment. And essentially, we can have a recession, or what would certainly feel like a recession, even if we had this relatively slow growth. It was growth, but relatively slow. Let me go ahead and add a couple more facts here. One is, most recessions are surprisingly small. In the grand scheme of things, most recessions cause 1-3% fall in GDP. Our most recent recession, in the Great Recession, was something like 4.8%. So it really was extraordinarily large. It isn't just sort of, you know, people being dramatic and sensationalistic to claim that it was really large. But most recessions are pretty small. And even this, if you sort of think about, oh, my income this year is 5% lower than it was last year, and, you know, instead of making $1,000 a month, I'm making $950 a month. For most of us, yeah, we wouldn't be happy about that. But it wouldn't be the worst thing in the world either. But what we see, in fact, is that the recessions are concentrated. It isn't that everyone's income goes down by 1 to 3% or even 4.5%. They're concentrated in particular industries. So our most recent recession was concentrated in the residential construction industry. Or previous recessions might have been concentrated in the high-tech industry when the tech bubble burst, or in the aerospace industry in the recession of the early 90s. So they're concentrated in particular industries, particular regions of the country, often because industries are located in particular regions, and of course in particular firms. Particular firms suffer more than others, and particular people suffer more than others. Some people go along and they don't lose their job at all, and their income stays the same, and other people just get hammered. So in many ways, the problem of recessions is not so much the problem of the recession itself, although that's bad. The problem of recessions can be called a problem of risk sharing. And how do we arrange some kind of risk sharing so that we don't have this concentrated harm which, you know, leaves a bunch of people untouched, but then some other people just get totally walloped? And this is sort of the argument for having something like unemployment insurance, that we make it so that, yes, even if you get walloped, we're going to put a floor under your level of income and consumption. Let me go ahead and stop it there. And